Hi, I'm Ran, a critical care fellow from OHSU. I want to talk about airway management in critically ill patients. Before we get too specific, though, I want to recognize that many medical providers responding to a critically ill patient, residents, hospitalists, nursing, will rarely, if ever, intubate. But they are the ones who direct the resuscitation, and therefore the intubation. Intubation is a very unique procedure in this way. It's not up to the proceduralist to decide whether and when to intubate someone. It's up to the resuscitationist, even if that resuscitationist never intubates. And that's why it's my favorite procedure. It's a blend of anatomy with physiology, proceduralist with resuscitationist. It's a topic that at its very core should make sense to everyone. Let's first start broad and talk about how intubation fits into a resuscitation. A stands for airway, not intubation. An airway simply refers to the potential for gas to move in and out of the lungs. Jaw thrust and suctioning are frequently all you need to open and clear an airway. Intubation is not necessarily the immediate next step. But if intubation is deemed necessary, it's important to back up and ask why, and therefore determine when. I start by asking myself, is intubation a therapy, a bridge to therapy, or a preventative therapy? In angioedema with any concerning respiratory signs, like stridor or tripoding, the plastic tube is the therapy. In these cases, intubation is a true priority. I don't need labs, I don't need imaging, I don't need drugs except for intubation drugs. I would use oxygen as a pre-treatment for the treatment of intubation. The optimal approach really depends on the situation, but in general, leave the awake patient in their most comfortable position. Every muscle in their body is fighting to keep airway patency and generate enough pressure gradient to move air through a high resistance path. Don't take them out of tripod and lay them flat. Don't sedate them deeply. Don't paralyze them, unless you are absolutely ready. Awake intubations are actually very helpful here. It doesn't rely on deep sedation or paralysis to be effective. And you can think of the fiber optic scope as an advanced small pathfinder through tight and distorted spaces. Thankfully, this is one of the more uncommon reasons for intubation. Very rarely is the plastic tube in and of itself therapeutic. Take the complete opposite example. An otherwise healthy young man needs semi-urgent surgery for symptomatic cholelithiasis. The endotracheal tube is now a bridge to a therapy, the therapy of surgery. Unlike the previous example, there is no incredible hurry to intubate. You would scrutinize every vital sign. You would get history, physical exam, review medications, allergies, and labs. You would screen for other medical problems and address the pressing ones first. The risks to intubating a healthy patient are incredibly low. If you were to rank them, you might say the biggest risk is aspiration. Second might be hypotension, then hypoxia, then acidosis. To minimize the risk of major aspiration, you make the patient MPO. And if the patient did eat, you might perform something called rapid sequence intubation. This is where a sedative and paralytic are given nearly simultaneously with no positive pressure ventilation before attempts at laryngoscopy. This way you don't insufflate the stomach, and with rapid paralysis, massive vomiting and aspiration is unlikely. Hypotension in this patient with a healthy heart can usually be treated with some IV fluid. Hypoxia can be mitigated with pre-oxygenation, which can delay time to desaturation in a healthy patient by 5 to 8 minutes. And apneic oxygenation can delay time to desaturation, depending on how you do it, by half an hour or more. Respiratory acidosis has very little deleterious effects here. Bag mask ventilation is usually adequate as rescue. Compare this to traditional sequence intubation, where we take a little bit longer to titrate sedatives to goal and bag the patient with a mask before using paralytics. There are a few caveats to rapid sequence. Since you are giving paralytics almost simultaneously with sedatives, you don't really have an opportunity to assess whether the level of sedation is adequate before paralysis sets in. That's why the doses of sedatives we use in rapid sequence are so high, and why some providers use multiple drugs in different classes. We err on the side of deeper than necessary sedation in case the patient has high tolerance or is a rapid metabolizer. The other caveat is a lack of checkpoints. You don't really have a feel for bagging this patient, so you don't know if this would be difficult should you require a plan B. So rapid sequence requires some modification, or at least some forethought in patients who might not tolerate high doses of sedatives, or who might be difficult to intubate / bag mask ventilate. Take this next very common example. A patient with sepsis who is febrile, tachycardic, hypotensive, densely encephalopathic, and difficult to arouse. Is intubation a therapy? No. That piece of plastic is not going to treat fever, tachycardia, hypotension, or encephalopathy. Probably will make it all worse. Some people might choose not to intubate this patient at all. It's a clinical judgment. But if you did, you would justify intubation as airway protection, preventing a possible future aspiration event, apnea event, or airway obstruction event. This patient is certainly sicker than our previous example, but it should be obvious to you that intubation is not the priority in this illness. Even if the GCS is 3, you have more pressing problems than preventing a potential future mishap. You have a now mishap. IV access, cultures, antibiotics, fluids take first priority. You try your best to normalize the vital signs, especially hypotension. When it comes to intubation itself, we again weigh the risk and consider how to modify them. The biggest risk here is hypotension. The change from negative pressure to positive pressure ventilation, as well as the circulatory depressant activity of sedatives, can put the patient's hemodynamics in a nosedive. With regards to intubation, you can use any approach, but the key is to use different doses of sedatives than the previous patient. You don't want the proceduralist to inject 200 mics of fentanyl and 200 milligrams of propofol. Animal experiments show that you need much less sedatives to achieve the same degree of sedation in shock physiology. And this is clinically obvious, since you are intubating this patient because they are unresponsive. They are starting off sedated. If you are to use any sedation at all, the goal is anxiolysis and amnesia. You don't need to go deep. In these cases, one might make the argument for traditional sequence intubation, where a small dose of sedative is given and clinically assessed for effect, or minimal sedation fiber optic intubation, or rapid sequence with just succinylcholine. Here's another case, a patient with multifocal pneumonia and hypoxic respiratory failure. Here, it's very important to first recognize that placing a tube in the trachea does not solve the problem in the lungs. Actually, intubation usually makes the situation worse. Oxygen is no longer the pretreatment. It is the treatment. Intubation is no longer a therapy. It is a bridge, an interface, for the therapy of mechanical ventilation. Similarly, in this case, don't rush to intubate. The priority is not to put the tube in. It is to put oxygen in. Use non-rebreather. Use high-flow nasal cannula. Use non-invasive positive pressure ventilation. The risks to this patient are hypoxia, hypotension, aspiration, then acidosis. What sometimes complicates the picture is hyperactive delirium. The patient is in distress, swatting away the oxygen, pulling out IVs. While it might be easier, and thus tempting, to just push the drugs and intubate, pre-intubation hypoxemia can be very dangerous because there is no reserve. Even a perfect, under 20-second intubation will result in pretty severe hypoxemia if your starting saturation is in the 80s. Any delays, hiccups, or poor patient reserve can easily result in cardiac arrest. The patient needs good positive pressure ventilation, ideally before pushing any sedatives. And if this isn't possible due to agitated delirium, then sedatives are used so the patients can tolerate positive pressure ventilation. Paralysis is actually not helpful. So it's better to delay until oxygenation is optimized with a bag, BiPAP, or ventilator through a mask with or without an oral or nasal airway. This is called delayed sequence intubation. The delay, ironically, is so that we can provide the actual therapy, oxygenation, earlier. Intubation is the delay to therapy. Some people even take it a step further, with a plan to place a supraglottic airway instead of an endotracheal tube after paralysis. One look, and if you can't see the vocal cords, just slide in the supraglottic airway and continue oxygenation and ventilation. This is called rapid sequence airway, and it doesn't force you to rely on the patient being an easy intubation or an easy mask. In the non-altered patient with hypoxemia, you have more options. With a fiber optic scope, you can actually intubate through BiPAP or high flow with no interruptions in their therapies. If it's not obvious by now, I love fiber optic intubations. It's great for the anatomically difficult airways and, as you now see, physiologically difficult airways. But it's uncommonly used, and no one wants to subject their sickest patients to their least familiar tool. It's for this reason that my friend Beck and I decided to practice on each other. It was pretty rough at first, but the rough patches were also the most educational. Enjoy our fifth run at elective awake nasal fiber optic intubation. I started by spraying some cetacaine. It's banana flavored. Lidocaine works too, it just tastes worse. I next spray some lidocaine with epi into the nose. Afrin works equally well. We found that lidocaine cream on a tongue depressor really helps to suppress the gag reflex, but a nasal approach really doesn't stimulate gag. I next place a 32 French nasal pharyngeal airway. Its outer diameter is about the same as a 7-0 Parker endotracheal tube, but it's softer, so it's better tolerated and dilates the nasal passages. Now we take the nasal pharyngeal airway out, and I place the tip of the endotracheal tube into his nose. You can also tape the endotracheal tube to the hub of your scope. I drive the scope through the largest opening in his nasal passage. You can see that the nasal pharyngeal airway did a good job dilating everything. It's super easy to access the vocal cords from this position. So we take advantage and spray lidocaine directly below and onto the vocal cords. Of the many topicalization strategies we tried, this was the most helpful in suppressing the cough and laryngospasm reflex. It's normal for the patient to cough during successful topicalization. Just come back to the oral pharynx. Coughing actually swirls the lidocaine around. In the meanwhile, we gently and slowly advance the endotracheal tube through the nose and into the oral pharynx. If there's a lot of secretions, it's better to use a Yankauer suction than your scope suction. In fact, we found it helpful to hook up the scope suction port to oxygen to blow secretions out of the way. When I think the tube is in the oral pharynx, I back the scope up. And there it is. Here, I justify my countless hours of video gaming. Sneak through the cords without touching anything. Don't rush this step. You can't jam the scope through. The toughest part is not over. It's time to advance the endotracheal tube the last few centimeters. This can be extremely uncomfortable, especially if the balloon brushes the vocal cords. In a real patient, it's best to have helpers ready to restrain and sedatives ready to push. For Beck, I'm letting him advance it slowly. There are a lot of differences between doing this to a volunteer and to a patient. In fact, there will be a lot of differences between different patients as well. But knowing what the patient goes through has helped me in tailoring an approach and anticipating difficulties. Nasal pharyngeal intubations are surprisingly well tolerated. Here is Beck intubating me while intubated. I hope you enjoyed this schema for thinking about intubation. Even if you never do this procedure, take an active role. You know the patient the best. Discuss your concerns and goals with the proceduralist to come up with a plan most suitable for your patient, minimizing risk and optimizing benefit.